Hi, Bob Kraft of TennisMinistry.org. Today we're going to talk about Elena Dementieva, recently retired from the WTA Women's Pro Tennis Tour, and just tell you a little bit about my contact with her and where she's at, and ask people to pray for her. I first met her. Her mother traveled with her extensively, Vera, and they were always together. And then at a few different tournaments, special kind of occasions, you would see her brother and her father, but it was very rare. I think, as I remember, I heard her father was working, so he wasn't really able to travel with her, and it was the mother. And when she first came on the tour for me, the early 2000s, she was someone that everybody knew was a good player. She was a good player. They didn't really know if she was going to be number one. I don't think anybody was thinking she'd be a number one ranked player in the world, but they did think that she would be in the top five. She had this situation where she could not serve with confidence, so she would double fault sometimes 8-10 times in a match or more, especially on key points. And everybody knew that, all the players, all the coaches, everybody knew that about her, that she had that problem in her game. And nobody knew how to solve that. That was something that took place when she was a junior, a child, a very young child. They didn't teach her the proper wrist rotation on her serve, and she used a very you could say improper stroke, we could say. And then her mother, who is very quiet but domineering, very protective of her daughter, and rightly so. As I was told by her mother, I'd sit with her mother and talk to her mother, and also Elena would be around. Elena pretty much would do her own thing. The mom would sits in a chair, and Elena goes off with the other girls on the tour, and she's friends. She's very sociable, so she'd spend time with the other girls, and then she'd sit with her mom sometimes, but mostly she was away with other people who are her own age. And Vera and I would talk, especially in the early stages, and so, you know, she was a little concerned about her daughter being very vulnerable on the tour. She was a very pretty girl, and she's absolutely right. Vera, there are predators, sexual predators on the pro tour, the coaches, the trainers, male and females, and I can share that in a future video. But, you know, if you release your daughter without a parent to look over her or someone very close to her, and she's young, there's very much a potential there can be some problems. So she was around for that reason. That's what Vera told me. And then she kind of gravitated where she started to, manage the practice courts, have Vera's rackets strung for her, set up bring the practice balls and so forth to Vera. And so she took a more active role, and during the practice times, Vera would pick up the balls, throw them to Elena. She didn't do that earlier in her career. She learned that from watching the other coaches and the way it was structured. And Vera didn't really have a coach that she worked with on a regular basis. They would come and go. And so Vera would kind of manage that part of it too, what the coaching part was. Vera was quite open, Elena was quite open to me and was willing to listen to me, but I didn't really know how to proceed because she's Russian. She's from a totally different culture than where I'm from. I didn't understand the spiritual background of Russia really, especially in the early days of me being on the pro tour. I had to study a lot to learn about where they come from, what they believe. And I do know a lot about communism, though, because I had a lot of training in that in the university and in the U.S. government. And then what happened was that Vera grew up in a communist environment. She's a physicist, as I remember, and she grew up in and she actually was indoctrinated with communism. She told me that. She said, "I grew up this way, and I don't really believe in a God." So she's an atheist. And she acknowledges that and doesn't have really an interest in wanting to learn more about God. And that was a hard part because here I couldn't really talk to Yelena through her mom because her mom wasn't interested in that. And I did call Yelena when she was at a tournament in Hong Kong directly, and I spoke to her directly. The mom said no problem for me to do that. So Yelena and I were able to have a communication, a friendly communication directly, and that's the way it needed to be in that particular case if I really wanted to share the Christ with her. But then you could say, you know, you never can say you get it totally right, because there's not, sometimes there's just not right and wrong. They're just, you just try your best and you pray that God will bless it. And it's, you know, there are certain things, decisions that have to be made that are gray areas. And so I went to Vera at some tournament, if I remember, it was the French Open, and I wanted to give her some Christian material in Russian. And I thought that I had enough of a relationship with her. I could talk to her and so forth and smile, and she'd always want to say hello to me. But she totally rejected it. And she made it really clear, you know, that she didn't want that at all. And from that moment on, there was a breakdown in the relationship between she and I. We couldn't really talk as friends anymore. It could be just smile and say hello to each other. You know, did I make a mistake? I don't know. I just tried the best I could under the circumstances, and I tried to use wisdom. And Yelena, you know, I didn't go around Vera to reach Yelena to talk to her, even though I should have, because I had enough of communication with her. But on the other hand, she's very close to her mom, and I didn't want to, you know, interfere in that. So it was a bit complicated, but I did the best I could with her, and she never really expressed an interest in knowing more about Christ. For sure, she was aware of who I was, what I was doing, and she knew I prayed for her, and that's the best I could do. So we pray for her now. She's off the tour. She played a tournament, the U.S. Open, that I was at, and she lost to Mary Pierce in the semifinals, and I was around Mary a lot at that time. And also Yelena and I had a very close relationship with her at that period of time. And so she came off the court, and I asked Yelena about this double timeout that Mary had taken, which actually changed the course of the match for an injury. And it changed the whole, Yelena was winning and Mary ended up winning. And she said that was no problem. You know, we still had that kind of able to communicate about some sensitive matters. But you know, I was limited in what I could do. And I did feel for her because I was at the, she was playing Capriati, Yelena was, and she had double faulted 4 points in a row in the center court, and people were laughing. The whole stadium was laughing at her. And that must, to me, that was painful. And even, sadly, it was even Capriati's, Stefano Capriati was laughing. And I thought, you know, not appropriate. And I felt so sorry for her. And from that point on, she really worked hard on her serve. She brought in different coaches to try to solve the problem with her serve. Olga from Russia, a very famous player back in the 70s. And I was around a lot when she was trying to help her with her serve and trying to change the way she did it. You know, but she had done it since she was 6 or 7 years old, so it wasn't easy to do. And she did make improvement on her serve. I saw her play matches where she actually could serve with a little bit more confidence. But there would always be that situation where it would break down in the most stressful circumstance. And the last match I saw her, just before she retired, I saw her in Beijing. I saw her at the Pilot Pen, and she didn't really look like she was having fun anymore with tennis. You know, before she'd smile and joyful, and then all of a sudden it was just show up, no smile on her face, get the job done. It became a job. And she played against Caroline Wozniacki, and she was playing the semifinals of the Pilot Pen. Now, Yelena was, in my opinion, had the best ground strokes of any woman player. She was very good on her ground strokes, hard hitter, very tough. And Caroline also has very good ground strokes, but she was coming up. She was number one in the world. She was, you know, just newly arrived in the top five, you could say, and Yellen had been there a long time. And all of a sudden, it was a very tight match, right down to the wire, and I was sitting right on the court watching both of them and being with them, actually, because they saw me before and after the matches. And under the pressure, the most critical point in the match, she double faults. And that happened two or three times, right at the toward the middle of the end of the match, you know, toward the end of, the say, the third set, if I'm guessing right. And all of a sudden, she just crumbled. You could just see it was like a balloon, the air being let out of a balloon. She could have won that match. She was there, and Caroline was wilting. Caroline Wozniacki was wilting under the pressure. And all of a sudden, with the serve that she could rely upon to win points, it lets her down, double faults, several times in the match. And from that, and you just saw that right at the end of the match, she looked like a deflated balloon, you know, and her confidence was gone. And she retired within, I think, right after the U.S. Open. That was it for her. And no surprise, but it was sad because she had so much more she could have done with her game. And that one aspect of her game is really what caused her retirement, probably more than anything. And plus the fact that she'd been on the tour traveling for years and years and always just traveled with her mother. She never really developed her own life outside of her mother being with her on the tour. So that's Elena Dementieva. Thanks.